Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning at Zion. Whether you are gathered with us online or gathered with us on site, we're really glad to have you. I'm intern Pastor Katie, if we haven't met yet. I'm here with Pastor Paul today, and we're delighted to be worshiping God together with you all this morning. I just have a handful of announcements as we get started. The first is that tomorrow is July. Weird. When did that happen? I don't know, but we have a lot of fun things coming up in July with our L2F2, which is Loveland Lutheran Faith Formation. So on next Sunday, there is a all-ages trivia at King of Glory. Dinner's going to be at 5. Trivia's going to be at 6. I think it's going to be a really great time. If you would like to get plugged into that, you can indicate so on your connection sheet. There's not like a check for it, but you can just write, like, tell me how to play trivia, and then we'll get in touch with you. And then also, so that's this upcoming Sunday. On Sunday the 14th, we're having our L2F2 annual pulpit swap. So the pastors here will be going to Trinity, the pastors at Trinity will be going to King of Glory, and the pastor at King of Glory will be coming here to preach amidst our congregations. And then afterwards, we're all going to gather at Mahaffey Park for an all-church picnic. It's going to be really fun. Hot dogs and hamburgers and veggie burgers and all that sort of stuff. So that's July 14th. If you would like to come, there is also a place to indicate that on your connection sheet here. And then we're just asking folks to bring a side to share, a chair or something to sit on, and then your own beverage. So that is for July 14th. It's going to be really fun. The other announcement that I have is that tomorrow is July. How did that happen? And with that comes Safe Lot. Safe Lot is back in our parking lot for the month of July. There's a place for you to indicate if you want to volunteer. And then Anita, our volunteer coordinator extraordinaire, will get you plugged in. We need folks to do laundry. We need folks to be lot hosts. We need folks to host meals. And so, great. So Anita said we need someone to prepare a meal this coming Tuesday and this coming Thursday. It's the first week of the month. So let's show extra hospitality to our neighbors that way. So Tuesday and Thursday, again, sign up on your connection sheet. Or there's also a QR code in your bulletin you can scan, and it'll take you straight to the sign-up link to provide that meal. Lots of other announcements in the bulletin this morning. Lots of fun things going on this summer here at church and outside of church. And as we begin or continue with our worship this morning, I invite you all to take a moment, feel the breeze. It's really nice. Feel the warm sun. Feel the comfortability of the chair where you are sitting, if you are at home or standing or laying down or whatever. And let's assume a posture of confession as we begin worship with confession and forgiveness.
Do you have the... In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the aid of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that attentive to your word we may confess our sins, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God, have mercy on us. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. Uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Amen.
Let's pray. Lord God, better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere, and we give you thanks that you prepare a place for each of us in our heavenly homes, even while you dwell with us in our earthly homes. Teach us by your Spirit to live our whole lives to your service, praise, and glory through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite any of the kids in Christ, we're all kids in Christ, but any of the younger kids in Christ to come forward for a message with Sandy.
Is it?
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, where should we be? I mean, it's kind of like, oh, you guys can go ahead and go right on over and sit there. All right. And I will, you guys aren't in the sun, so it's okay if I stand over here. Let's begin with our sign. God be in my head, God be in my heart, God be on my left, and God be on my right. Today, we are learning and about home and how home is so much of a part of us. So the story that today is going to be about two brothers, Jacob and Esau. Oh, hold it. I should say Esau and Jacob. And they were together a long time ago, and Isaac was their dad. Is this story, does Esau and Jacob ring any bells for you guys? Okay, all right. Maybe they'll be ringing a little bit later. So Jacob was a trickster, and he liked to play, he played a very important trick on Esau, now his brother. So then he stole something from Esau that was rightfully his. So they lived as a family. Do you have tricksters in your house?
Yes.
Yeah. Your cat, yeah, okay. And then sometimes it's really funny that tricks that they play. Uh-huh, yeah. And sometimes it's really fun to play tricks on somebody else, okay? But in this case, it was not something that was very pleasant for Esau, the trick that Jacob had. And so they parted their ways. And then many years later, they came back together. They had families of their own. And Jacob was a little bit apprehensive, like shaking in his boots when they were going to get together. How is Esau going to treat me now after I did that terrible trick on him? And so, but Esau was so ecstatic for seeing Jacob. He just ran to him and smothered him with the biggest bear hug ever. How do you think that made Jacob feel? Huh. Exactly. Confused. Surprised. But Esau was so happy, so joyful that his brother was there and that he got to see him again. Huh. Joy. Joyful. Makes me think of joy. So when we think of joy, it begins with the letter J. If we think of Jesus, and then the O, others, and then the Y being you. Jesus, others, you. Esau was feeling so joyful to seeing Jacob again. Oh, joy, joyful. That reminds me of a song I'm for sure a lot of you may know. Sing along with me if you can remember it. I got the joy, 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 joy down in. Joyful to finally be able to see Jacob. And that helped to bridge the family a little bit at that time. So hopefully, when you think of joy, think of Jesus, others, you, and then you can't help but have that joy trickle into your lives. Inside out, from the inside out. I love it. I love it. Let's go ahead and pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you very much for the joy you place in our hearts.
Thank you very much for the joy you place in our hearts.
Thank you for the families you have gifted us with.
Thank you for the families you have gifted us with.
And may joy spread throughout.
And may joy spread throughout.
In Jesus' precious name. Amen.
This is the last week with this memory verse, so let's see how well we've gotten it stuck in our brains. Well, read it all together first, and then we'll do it with the signs. So if you need to stand up to see, let's read it all together first. For by grace we have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Ephesians 2:8. So remember, we're only signing the underlined words. Let's try it together. So, For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God. Ephesians 2:8. Thanks, everybody. You can have a seat.
Hello.
Oh, she got it.
She's smart
in disguise.
So, you read this part at the end. So read the whole thing.
What did I say?
This at the end.
Oh, guys, I'm stupid. Okay.
You're not stupid.
I know it says Annalise, but I'm not Annalise. I'm Shyla, if you didn't know. So this is a reading from Genesis chapter 33. Now Jacob looked up and saw Esau coming, and 400 men with him. So he divided the children among Leah and Rachel, and the two maids. He put the maids with their children in front, then Leah with her children, and Rachel and Joseph last of all. He himself went on ahead, bowing himself to the ground 7 times until he came near his brother. But Esau ran to meet him and embraced him and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept. When Esau looked up and saw the woman and children, he said, "Who are these with you?" Jacob said, "The children whom God has graciously given your servants. Oh my God. Then the maids drew near, and their children bowed down. Leah likewise, and her children Likewise, and her children drew near and bowed down. And Joseph and Rachel drew near. Oh my God, I said that. I'm sorry. Bowed down. Esau said, "What do you mean by all this company I have met?" Jacob answered, "To find favor with my lord." But Esau said, "I have enough, my brother. Keep what you have for yourself." Jacob said, "No, please. If I find favor with you, then accept my present from my hand. For truly, to see your face is like seeing the face of God, since you have received me with such favor. Please accept my gift that is brought to you, because God has dealt graciously with me, and because I have everything I want." So he urged him, and he took it. Word of God, word of life.
Here.
Sorry. You good?
Hi, guys.
Our second reading this morning comes from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 6. And this is Moses speaking to the Israelites before they have entered the promised land. So this is Moses saying, "Now this is the commandment, the statutes, and the ordinances that the Lord your God has charged me to teach you to observe in the land that you are about to cross into and occupy, so that you and your children and your children's children may fear the Lord your God all the days of your life, and keep all his decrees and his commandments that I am commanding you, so that your days may be long. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe them diligently, so that it may go well with you, and so that you may multiply greatly in a land flowing with milk and honey, as the Lord, the God of your ancestors, has promised you. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God, the Lord alone. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. Keep these words that I am commanding you today in your heart. Recite them to your children and talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise. Bind them as a sign on your hand, fix them as an emblem on your forehead, and write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. This morning, we are arriving at the last week of our Down and Out worship series. Throughout these 5 Sundays of June, we have visited the many places that God's grace takes us. God is at work in us, justifying us and calling us out into the world through our vocations. God's grace moves through our congregation, calling us to be church-going insiders and gospel-carrying outsiders. God's grace compels us to act on behalf of our neighbors and community, whether we wanna or we gotta. The wellspring of God's grace flows up through us in our many and various places of work. And God's grace follows us to one of the most intimate places of our lives, our homes. So as we begin this morning, I wanna invite us all to just take a minute here and think about your home. Really visualize it. You can close your eyes if you want. I'm gonna give a couple prompts. So this doesn't have to be the place where you currently live. You could be thinking of your childhood home or a place you call your home away from home. Doesn't even have to be a building. As you think about your home and visualize it, think about who is there. Who is missing? What memories come to the surface from this place? What do you love about this home? What might you wish to be different about it? Our homes, many and various as they may be, are one of the most intimate places in our lives. Our homes, whether big or small, are places of proximity. We are close to those who live in our homes. Our homes, even the most Hallmark Channel looking ones, are places of conflict and resolution, harm and healing, pain and promise. Jacob and Esau knew a little bit about this complicated nature of home. Sandy gave us a preview, but here is a 30-second summary, I'm gonna try to keep it short, of Jacob and Esau's home life, all right? So Jacob and Esau's parents are Isaac and Rebekah. Jacob and Esau were twins. Even when they were in the womb, they were wrestling, and when they were born, Jacob came out holding on to Esau's heel. The name Jacob means to replace or to supplant. From the beginning, Jacob was always trying to get ahead of his just slightly older brother. Esau never could shake his tricky younger brother, and as they grew, it became apparent that Isaac loved Esau more, and Rebekah loved Jacob more. I don't have kids of my own, but I've heard that pretty sound parenting advice is to not show favoritism to your children. Yeah, this is a story of how not to engage in fair parenting. Esau was the oldest kid. So he was supposed to get their father Isaac's blessing. And a father's blessing was a really big deal in this time. I don't think we have an exact correlation in our day and age, but we might think of it as an inheritance. Esau was supposed to be the sole inheritor of all his parents had until Jacob swooped in and, with their mother's help, managed to trick Isaac into giving him the father's blessing instead of giving it to Esau. Talk about a sibling rivalry and some complicated family dynamics. Now, you may not have experienced anything this extreme or this devious in your household. You may have actually experienced something more extreme or more devious in your household. But whether or not there is a direct parallel between your story and Jacob and Esau's story, their home, their story, reflects the reality that homes are places where the boundary between self and others can get a little blurry. We are physically and emotionally close to those we share our homes with, and the vulnerability in those relationships leaves us open to give and receive love in unique, beautiful ways. And it also leaves us at risk of giving and receiving harm in pretty unique, particular ways. Whatever your lived experience with your family, the home is a place where God's unconditional love can be lived out. And it is often a place where our human brokenness can be most acutely on display. When the lockdown days of the COVID-19 pandemic forced the entire country indoors, many of us had safe spaces to shelter in place, and many of us didn't. For those of us who did have places to stay, our household dynamics suddenly became unavoidable. I was living with three housemates at the time. I was in grad school, and one of my housemates created a weekly schedule for us that included a sports day one day, movie night one day, game night one day, and some scheduled study time to try to give us a semblance of normalcy and also to give us something to do so we didn't drive each other too crazy. Do y'all remember what your households did during those days? For some people, the lockdown did offer a chance to meaningfully reconnect with people in your household. For some people living alone, the lockdown exacerbated feelings of loneliness that might have already been there, and it became overwhelmingly isolating. For some people, being forced to stay in their homes was actually dangerous. One study found that incidents of domestic violence increased by 8% during the early days of the lockdown. Our homes are places of conflict and resolution, harm and healing, pain and promise. Our homes are places where we need God's grace to flow. Martin Luther said that the home is the first point of catechism or teaching, and that is true whether you are raising kids or caring for an aging family member, whether you are cooking dinner for one or learning how to live with a roommate for the first time. Our homes are often the first places we learn about faith. They are the closest environments where we can practice being like Christ. They are the places where we most often need to stop and say, I'm sorry. Deuteronomy tells us that we are to keep the word of God in our homes so that we may have life and health and faith. The word of God belongs in our homes so that it may go well with us all the days of our lives. The word of God belongs in our hearts, on our foreheads, in our lips, on the doorpost, because that's how often we need reminding of God's grace in our homes. That's how often we will also have the opportunity to follow the flow of God's grace into our homes and with our families. I wonder, as you visualized your home this morning, where is God's grace apparent there? Where might you need to ask God to send a little more grace in your home? When we meet Jacob and Esau this morning, we are witnessing their first contact after Jacob ran away from their home with Esau's blessing. Many years have passed, and Jacob seems appropriately anxious, quaking in his boots, like Sandy said, for how his brother Esau is going to receive him. Jacob, before meeting his brother, orders his household from least favorite to most favorite. Again, not a great parenting strategy. And then he himself leads them. He is alone and vulnerable in the face of his brother. He is coming face to face with the recipient of his wrongdoing all those years ago. Jacob even bows down 7 times in an act of submission to his brother. And then Esau runs to him, embraces him, falls on him, and kisses him. Esau weeps with J-O-Y joy at the sight of his long-lost brother. Isn't it interesting how Esau is the one who shows God's grace in this familial relationship? Jacob might have been the chosen and blessed one, but Esau is the one who shows us what God's unconditional love looks like. Jacob may have made it out of their house with his father's blessing, but our heavenly Father did not forget about Esau and his household. During this brotherly reunion, we learn that Esau has been doing okay, despite having his father's blessing stolen from him. Esau says to Jacob, "I have enough, my brother." Esau says, "You may have hurt me and deceived me and stolen from me and run from me, but God has been faithful to me." Jacob and Esau's story shows us that no matter how severe a conflict, no matter how deeply rooted in the past, reconciliation between brothers is possible. And God does not forsake us, even when our human family fails us. And Jacob and Esau's story also shows us that reconciliation within the home does not have to end with an extremely close physical or emotional relationship. We didn't read this part this morning, but right after the brothers' reunion, they go separate ways. They have met, they have reconciled, and then they leave each other with the faith that God is big enough to go with both of them and each of their households. God's grace is big enough. God's grace takes us into our congregations, our communities, the places where we work, and the places where we live. And God is faithful to us. Even when we harm other people, even when we are on the painful receiving end of someone else's mistake or harm, God's grace spills out into those places, spills over into all of the world. And I can't wait to see where God's grace will take us next. Amen. For our sacred space this morning, we have our seasonal prayer station still, prayer flags. If you would like your prayer read aloud this morning, leave it on the table. If you would like it not read aloud, you can go ahead and put it in the garden or take it back to the seat, your seat with you. Also on this table up here, we have new bookmarks because this upcoming Sunday is a new season. So there's new bookmarks on the table for you if you'd like that. And then finally, if you look in the front of your bulletin, we've got some reflection questions like we have this whole series. And actually this morning, we only have one question. To what in your home is God calling you? Below this question, you'll see this thing that looks kind of like a pie. and this is a sort of summary activity. As we think about where God's grace takes us in our lives, you're invited to fill out the inner circle with people or organizations or issues that are close to you in your work, in your congregation, in your community, in your leisure activities, and in your home. That's the inside. And then on the outside circle, you're invited to write your wishes for those people or those organizations and reflect on how God might be directing God's grace through you in each of those areas. We all have vocations. We all have areas of ministry. And this is to help us think more concretely about those places that touch our lives and our vocations. So you are invited to reflect on this while Neil plays. You are invited to write a prayer, all of the above. Welcome to this sacred space. Held together by the faithfulness of God, we confess our faith with the use of the Apostle Creed, printed in your bulletin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We come before the triune God to pray for our communities, ourselves, our homes, and our world. God of abundance, you fill your church with a multitude of gifts. Sustain those among us who feel that their gifts or their selves are not valued. Open our hearts to the wondrous diversity of all who call upon your name. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of creation, your goodness abounds throughout the universe and throughout the earth. Multiply greatly the fruits of the earth and rescue it from our wastefulness. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of justice, you reign in steadfast love. Bring peace between nations ravaged by war or strife, and illumine paths of justice and freedom for those who lead them. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of compassion, your touch brings healing and your word gives life. Hear our prayers for Eden, KB, Bill Markham, Betty Padilla, Mary Drain, Shirley Campbell, Colleen Ligotke, Dennis Bernhardt, Jan Picard, Elaine Hart, Becky, Anna Ellers, who is Janice's granddaughter, hospitalized this week. For Kate Barnes, for Mike, Jill, Jay, Mike Slavic, Father Charles McCarthy, Carolyn Schultz, Steve, Lynette, Angelo, Joe, Laura, Rosemary, and Jim Poppy. Hold in your arms all who are in need. Turn our wailing into dancing and our weeping into joy. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of community, you gather us at your table of plenty. May our homes and families be places where your love shows forth. Where there is hunger among us, open our hands. Where we are indifferent to the needs of others, open our hearts. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of new life, we give you thanks for the gift of baptism, and especially for those in our community celebrating their baptismal birthdays this week. Pam, Stieg, Autumn, Bailey, Chuck, Donna, Kate, and Lynn. God of grace, hear our prayer. God of the ages, great is your faithfulness. We remember in thanksgiving our beloved dead, especially Gay, who is Kathy Pancoast's friend. Remember us all in your kingdom until we, with all the saints, sing without ceasing in your realm of glory. God of grace, hear our prayer. We pray for God's presence, peace, and love to reside in sober living and in our home. May all women come to know him. Thank you, God, for the heart of this person who prayed this prayer and for their home. God of grace, hear our prayer. Holy God, holy and merciful, into your outstretched arms we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. And may the peace of Christ be with you always. Please share a sign of that peace with one another and with those gathered online. Peace. Peace, Pastor Paul.
Love it.
Do you want to help me?
She's going to make an announcement. I forgot.
As we prepare for our time of offering today, I just want to remind everybody that if you are a visitor, you are by no means obligated to give unless you have heard something today that's moving your heart to give to our shared mission. If you are not a visitor, you are also not obligated to give. But this is a way that we live out our mission of sharing God's abundance. One of the huge ways that God's abundance has shown forth this month is through the fundraiser and item drive we did for Matthew's House, led by our confirmation students. So I have Shyla up here again with me to give an update on the final status of our fundraiser. And Shyla hasn't seen these numbers yet, so it's gonna be a surprise. So, we raised this much money. Yeah.
Okay, so apparently we raised $2,090.
Yeah, $2,090.
I love you guys.
And this many items.
701 items.
Yeah. Thank you. So as this was a effort of all of our confirmation students, which is across all three churches, those are the numbers from all three of our churches. So isn't it amazing what God can do when we combine our resources? This afternoon, I'm going over to Trinity with all our stuff to give to Pastor Kari to take to Matthew's House up in Fort Collins. So thank you, everyone. Now is our time to respond with joy in offering.
I can only imagine.
Let us pray. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of the one who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks and gave it for all to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." At this time, we begin by communing those gathered here online who will be remaining in their seats to receive this gift. If you are someone here and didn't get a kit on the way in and you would like one, raise your hand and usher will bring one. Okay. Let us pray as our Lord has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So if you're at home or here and you have the kit, take your bread and hear these words. The body of Christ is given for you. Then you may take your wine, water, whatever it is that you might have at home, or if you're here and have a kit, peel that off and hear these words. The blood of Christ is shed for you. Amen. Now at this time, I would invite those assisting with communion to please come forward, and there will be two stations for communion. Come to the table, for all is ready.
And as we leave this place to our homes, to our workplaces, to our leisure activities, know that you go with God's blessing. God who provides for us, feeds us, and journeys with us now and forever. Amen.
Yes. Before we begin our last piece, I made an error in the bulletin. We're going to start with the first verse before we go to the chorus.
So oh, nice.
Just be aware of that, if you would. Thank you so much. Ready?
Able to help put up chairs before you go, that would be really great. And then when you're ready to go, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. And we will.